Hi. In this tutorial, we are going to take an in-depth look at Extension Pack's new node editor. The node editor is quite a powerful tool that allows you to edit the exposed node attributes of materials, groups, and custom procedurals, giving you complete control over attribute grouping, tabs, names, default values, etc. Basically, everything you need to have a node with an organized node property setup, you should be able to do in the node editor interface. Mari natively does have its own node editor, which you can find by selecting a material or group node and clicking on this inconspicuous little button up here. The problem with Mari's own node editor is that it is extremely limited, basically only allowing you to rename or delete existing attributes, without giving any UI control over, for example, grouping or even tab creation. And those are only the main issues. The new Extension Pack node editor can be launched from the right mouse click edit menu, or via the hotkey Alt and K. However, for it to open, you do need the right node type selected, such as for example this material node. So now I'm editing an Extension Pack material template from the shelf, which has a lot of attributes. Those complex Extension Pack templates were authored with a very early version of this tool that I had developed for that purpose. And without it, just using the standard Mari node editor, you would not be able to achieve material properties that look like this. I have my table view here, which lists all attributes that have been exposed from the inside of the material to the outside. I can directly edit values here via a double click or enter key press. Here on the right, I have the tree view, which is a visual representation of the way my node properties will look. Here, for example, I have my base color attribute, and by selecting it, its corresponding row automatically got highlighted in my table view. I can directly rename the displayed name of the attribute in the tree view, and it will update in the table view as well. It won't, however, auto-update in the node properties until it has been applied. Mari's own node editor always live applies any changes, which can make it extremely slow. In this editor instead, you need to hit apply or press hotkey 1, and then the node will be updated. Now you might have noticed that I can still interact with the Mari main window, even though the node editor is open. The node editor will stay on top of Mari by default, but you can change this by clicking this pin icon down here. If I click off the dialog now, then it will disappear behind the Mari window in this case. Mostly you will be interested in creating nice groupings for your nodes. So we can, for example, rename groups in this tree view, and you can see the table updated. I can also go in the table view and edit, for example, the tab column here, and the tree view will update vice versa with my new tab. And since I had a group defined, the group also got auto-created within that tab. I can also create a new tab up here with this button and then drag and drop the group into it. The tab I previously created via the table view disappeared now because it was empty. Any tab or group that was existing when the node editor was launched or that was created via the table view will be auto-deleted when empty. However, groups or tabs that were manually created by the buttons up here will not be auto-deleted. So this way you can, if you want, create a tab and group structure first, and then fill them with the attributes after by dragging them into it. Speaking of groups, we can also define if a group should be open or closed by default when the properties of a node are opened. If I select this group here, which is closed in my node properties, and click this button, you will see the icon slightly changes. If I apply this change now, the group will be open by default when the node properties are loaded. Up here we have some other options, the first one being the attribute linker. With this dialog you can create linked attributes, meaning you have one exposed attribute on the material and it controls multiple attributes within the material. You can see each attribute has an icon that represents the type of the attribute, and of course you can only link attributes of the same type. Here for example we could link together those two exposed float attributes into one single attribute. The name of the new attribute can be set down here. And if I confirm this dialog, the new attribute is created down here in this linked group, and I can either move the attribute somewhere else or rename the group. Next, we have some node graph jump options. If I select an attribute in my tree view and do a single click on this first button, then the node properties of the node will open, which is modified by that selected attribute. If I double click on the button, then the node graph will jump to the node itself. Here in the table, we have our attribute source column, which lists the node attribute this exposed attribute controls. Here in this row, we have an attribute where only one node attribute is linked to it. But here, for example, we have a linked attribute where one setting controls multiple other settings. Using the jump options on a so-called linked attribute like this, will give a pop-up dialog to choose which node to jump to. While we are at it, let's see what happens if I expose a new attribute while the editor is open. The node editor automatically registered the change, and when I press reload, voila, here's my new attribute ready to be edited. Of course, I can also unexpose attributes this way, and it's gone. Now that I jumped my node graph and node properties to another node, of course I want to be able to go back to my original material node again. So this is the next button here. Again, single click brings up the node properties, a double click jumps the node graph. A lot of these buttons up here also have hotkeys assigned. So for example, all of this jumping can be done with hotkeys, but also the creation of groups, tabs, and their open-close states, which we covered before. Finally, we have the delete button, which we can use to delete empty tabs and groups, as well as attributes. Here we have another improvement over the default Mari node editor. You can see this attribute has a total of 14 connections linked together. Let's jump to one of the node properties and unexpose just one. Again, the node editor registers the change and I can reload the node, but the entire attribute is actually gone now. Mari kills all 14 connections by unexposing a single attribute that is part of a linked attribute. The node editor handles this a lot better and allows you to just remove one of the links without affecting the others. Let's find another attribute that has a lot of connections, like this one, and press delete. Now we get a list of what connections we want to kill, or if we want to delete all of them, just like Mari does. A nice thing about this dialog is that it is node selection aware. So let's cancel this quickly and jump to one of those nodes that are part of the link. Let's make sure the node is selected and then press delete attribute again. You can see my selected node is now listed at the top of this dialog and pre-selected. So this small convenience feature allows you to navigate to one or multiple nodes where you want to break the link, and you will get the same selection in this delete window. Now let's move on to the table view. We have a lot of different columns here, but you can arrange them freely the way you want. The column order and width is saved and restored, as well as the general UI resizing of, for example, these splitters. If we scale the dialog to its minimum width and height, then it will enter a dynamic mode the next time you launch the node editor, meaning it will try to find the best size for your amount of attributes on your node. In the table view itself, we have some red columns where you can't edit these cells, but all others you can double-click to change a value or press enter. Whenever I do change a value, I get an undo entry in the log view here on the right. The undo is non-linear, meaning that I can go to any entry and just undo that one, even if it is not the last one in the list. For the table columns, we have some cells that have clicked on auto-sync the selection to the tree view. However, usually value cells, such as this one, don't sync their selection. You can, however, force sync the selection by pressing the hotkey S from any column. And then we have the attribute selected in the tree view again, even if it didn't do it automatically. A lot of these columns also have right mouse click menus that are specific to the column or the attribute type. So here, for example, I can copy the value of the field or set it as a search term up here in the filter section. You can use the filter section to narrow down the table list based on keywords. And you can target only specific columns by selecting it from this dropdown or by removing a target by clicking on one of the buttons down here. Back to the table, if I go to the current value column, we already have a bunch more in the right mouse click menu. Copy paste, but I can also, for example, push the current value as the new default value. The default value is the one Mario reverts to when you press this R button in the node properties next to an attribute. You can also push all current values of all attributes in a single click to be the new default this way, by the way. Then we have scene syncing. So let's say you made some changes to attributes in your scene while this dialog was open, and using this option, we can just sync these changes back into our open node editor. Finally, we have the reset to reset the value to what it was when the dialog was launched, and again our set as search. If we check the menu for the current value on these color fields, we have even more options, such as toggling the scalar mode or using some of our color presets. If we right mouse click in the default column, yet another context menu, but here we can apply, for example, the defaults as current value. And finally, on the minimum and maximum value column, we have this remove minimum or maximum entry. The minimum and maximum define, like you would expect, the range of sliders. If you remove either the minimum or maximum from a slider, Mari converts the UI field from a slider to a number field where you can freely enter a value. In terms of editing values, we have a bunch of different user interface elements. Double-clicking on this one, for example, I will just edit the numbers. Double-clicking on this one, I can choose the current value from a dropdown. Here, for example, we have a Mari curve attribute, and if I want to edit this, I will get this dialog where I can see and edit all the individual curve points. The node editor supports really all possible data types a Mari attribute can have, so we won't go through all of the different interface items as it is quite a few. Let's quickly cover some of those remaining columns. The description field allows you to set a tooltip on an attribute. So, for example, if you are a lead artist and are authoring a material for your team, you can add additional info what an attribute does this way. Next, we have the step column. We have seen just before when we removed the minimum or maximum from a value field, how Mari then created a text field for the attribute. If we add a step value via the column, then Mari converts this field into what is called a spin box. In a spin box, we have these additional buttons to increase or decrease the value as defined by the step. If I want to get rid of this again, right mouse click on the step cell and choose the remove option. Finally, we have the itemlist column. In a nutshell, this column allows you to edit and create custom dropdown menus for your materials, where you can precisely name the contents of the dropdown to show the user what it does. We will cover itemlists and custom dropdowns in a dedicated tutorial, and the link to that one can be found in the video description of this video, as well as on YouTube in the upper right corner just about now. Before I wrap this tutorial up, let's talk about two special features of the node editor. The first one is the node comparison mode. If I select two eligible nodes, for example two materials, and launch the node editor, I will get a choice of which node I want to edit. The second node will be displayed at the bottom in a view-only mode. While you can't edit the values of that second node down here, you can, for example, copy values over into the node you are editing by right mouse clicking and choosing copy and pasting the values then up here. The last thing to talk about are hidden attributes. The node editor can edit any kind of value or data that sits on a node. While for you, the user, only the attributes are interesting, nodes often have additional information stored on them, a so-called metadata. You can display this protected data up here. Here, for example, we have an extension pack metadata entry that provides various info about the material type, so it can be read out by a Python. One interesting hidden attribute is the shader model. Mari materials are tied to certain shader models. Each shader type that appears here in the creation menu of the shader palette is its own shader model, and materials only correctly auto-connect to a shader if they are the exact same shader model. This limitation leads to curious cases where, for example, a material that was authored as an Arnold standard surface shader doesn't connect to the new Autodesk standard surface shader model, even though the input ports are exactly the same. Using the node editor, we can easily change this by finding the shader model entry and simply changing it and applying it. This concludes this tutorial, and I hope from now on you will find that editing a material to be reused by you or a team of artists is a lot less of a chore than it was before. Thanks for listening.